of 1930s and 40s,
where a lot of European scientists are migrating to the US because of their fascist governments.
The nuclear story begins in February 1932 when the neutron is discovered by the British physicist James Chadwick. Then in April 1932, the Italian-American physicist Enrico Fermi and his team in Rome conducted experiments involving the bombardment of elements by slow neutrons, which produced heavier elements and isotopes. After a few years, in December 1938, German chemists Otto Hahn and Fritz Strassmann discovered nuclear fission, which was followed by a theoretical explanation by Elise Meitner and Otto Frisch, which made the development of an atomic bomb a theoretical possibility. Nuclear fission is the process in which a neutron hits a large atom, splitting it into two smaller atoms, more neutrons, and a lot of energy. These neutrons can then further hit the atoms, releasing a lot of energy. This whole process is called a nuclear chain reaction. Leo Szilard, a Hungarian physicist, was aware of the power of the nuclear chain reaction and how it could be used to create nuclear weapons to empower the military of a country. On seeing the German progress in the nuclear field, he urged Albert Einstein to exert his influence and then wrote a letter to the then US President Franklin D. Roosevelt to start nuclear research in the country. The Einstein-Szilard letter urged that the United States should start acquiring stockpiles of uranium ore and accelerate the research of nuclear chain reactions under Enrico Fermi and other scientists. This letter can be seen as one of the major reasons of the nuclear research starting in the US, which further led to the Manhattan Project. After this, President Franklin D. Roosevelt called on Lyman Briggs to head the Advisory Committee on Uranium to investigate the fission of uranium as a result of the Einstein-Szilard letter. Lyman Briggs held a meeting attended by Szilard, Wigner, and Edward Teller. The committee reported back to Roosevelt saying that uranium would provide a possible source of bombs with a destructiveness vastly greater than anything now known. After this, the US Navy awarded Columbia University $6,000 in funding, most of which Enrico Fermi and Szilard spent on purchasing graphite. Meanwhile, in Britain, in June 1939, Frisch and Rudolf Diels at the University of Birmingham had calculated that around 10 kg of uranium would be required for a nuclear weapon, which was small enough to be carried by any bomber of the day. This came to be known as the Frisch-Diels Memorandum, which initiated the British atomic bomb project known as Tube Alloys, and also the MAUD Committee, which created two reports suggesting that the nuclear chain reaction could be used for military as well as a source of energy. The MAUD committee concluded that an atomic bomb was not only feasible, it was inevitable. They also pointed out that a large part of a laboratory in Berlin had been devoted to nuclear research. Even though Britain was ahead of the US in nuclear research, it did not have the resources to proceed ahead practically. In July 1940, Britain offered to give the United States access to its scientific research. John Krakow from Britain briefed the American scientists on the British developments and found that the American project was not as far advanced as the British one. Physicist Mark Oliphant from Britain flew to the United States in the late August 1941 and discovered that the data provided by the MAUD committee had not reached the key American physicist. He made sure that the key American physicists were aware of the potential power of the atomic bomb. Then, on October 11, 1941, Franklin D. Roosevelt agreed to sign a secret cooperation agreement with the UK. Roosevelt issued Executive Order 8807, creating the Office of Scientific Research and Development, that is OSRD. The Uranium Committee of the OSRD came to be known as the S1 section for security reasons. It is important to note that behind all these developments, the motivation was that the Germans were ahead in the nuclear research and they might develop a nuclear bomb earlier. While all this was happening, on December 7, 1941, the Japanese bombed the Pearl Harbor, which leads to the US entering the World War II. After this bombing, on 18 December 1941, the S1 committee held a meeting with an atmosphere of enthusiasm and urgency. The Japanese bombing tilted the nuclear research till now to a military point of view. Things started moving pretty fast. In June 1942, a proposal was made for $54 million for construction by the United States Army Corps of Engineers, $31 million for research and development by OSRD, and $5 million for contingencies. President Franklin D. Roosevelt approved by writing OKFDR on the document. July 1942, Robert Oppenheimer and Fermi convened meetings at the University of Chicago and tentatively confirmed that a fission bomb was theoretically possible. Edward Teller, a participant in these meetings, pushed for the discussion of a more powerful bomb, which is now referred to as the hydrogen bomb, based on the fusion principle. He also raised the speculative possibility that an atomic bomb might ignite the atmosphere because of a hypothetical fusion reaction of nitrogen nucleus. Hans Bethe, another participant, refused to move in the direction of nuclear fusion and instead asked to concentrate on the nuclear fission developments. All these research and developments is what we now know as the Manhattan Project. Till the year 1943, the work on the design and functioning of the bomb itself was largely theoretical, based on the fundamental experiments carried out at a number of different locations. In that year, a laboratory directed by J. Robert Oppenheimer was created at Los Alamos, which later came to be known as Project Y. The plan was that before sufficient amounts of uranium were available, they start construction of a weapon that could be dropped from a plane and be detonated in the air above the target. We can say during the Manhattan Project, Hanford and Oak Ridge came to be the suppliers of uranium and plutonium, whereas Los Alamos, headed by Robert Oppenheimer, was the practical playground for testing these out. By the summer of 1945, sufficient amounts of uranium and plutonium were available from Hanford and Oak Ridge, and weapon development and design were sufficiently advanced, which led to an actual field test of a nuclear explosive in New Mexico. The site was called Trinity, and the plutonium-based bomb was called the Gadget. The first atomic bomb was exploded at 5:30 a.m. on July 16, 1945, 120 miles south of Albuquerque, New Mexico.
We knew the world would not be the same. Few people laughed. Few people cried. Most people were silent. I remembered the line from the Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita. Vishnu is trying to persuade the prince that he should do his duty, and to impress him, takes on his multi-armed form and says, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds." I suppose we all thought that one way or another.
The bomb generated an explosive power equivalent to 20,000 tons of TNT. The interesting fact is that the worst case scenario designated for this experiment was that it could destroy the whole Earth due to the chain reaction of fusion of nitrogen atoms. But the experiment was a success, and which led to the creation, as we all know, of two bombs known as Little Boy and Batman, which were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Hiroshima was selected as the primary target because of its military value. The city was the home to the headquarters of the Japanese Second Army. This led to the Japanese delegation surrendering on September 2, 1945. This atomic bomb led to 70,000 to 1,26,000 civilians being killed in Hiroshima, whereas 60,000 to 80,000 in Nagasaki. There were arguments from both sides on the atomic bomb being used in the war. Some said it would stop wars in the future, whereas some said that it was absolutely unnecessary. I think the fact that we will all agree on is that the Manhattan Project led to an exponential growth in the nuclear research in a decade, between 1930s and 40s. Such fast growth would not have been possible without the fear of the Germans creating the bomb first, or without the Japanese bombing the Pearl Harbor. Which leads us to think that everything is indeed possible, but we have to answer the question first, for what reasons?